All right, we are going back to comic films today, and I'm looking at arguably the most popular franchise in the recent history of comic book film adaptations, and that's the X-Men franchise. Before we begin, I think it would be appropriate to go through a little history on how this franchise got started. Development of the first film dated all the way back to 1989. In fact, James Cameron was originally in the director's chair, but that deal wound up going down the tubes. In fact, the entire film company handling the project, Carol Cove Films, went completely bankrupt as well. Marvel wound up selling the rights to Fox in 1994, and Bryan Singer signed on to direct in 1996. After a few rewrites, the film finally began production in 1999 and finally released in July of 2000. The movie was not exactly given the greatest of action movie budgets. In fact, Bryan Singer and the producers of the film had to fight with Fox in order to get a suitable budget. Fox was more than apprehensive because X-Men would be the first big comic book adaptation in over 3 years, and the previous films, Batman and Robin and the Phantom, were two humongous flops, so naturally Fox was hesitant about putting in a lot of money into X-Men. The story is about Magneto and his partners Mystique, Toad, and Sabretooth trying to turn the entire city of New York into mutants with a device that he created, and it's the X-Men's job to stop him. The X-Men for this film consist of Cyclops, Jean Grey, Storm, and Wolverine. The film also introduces Rogue and Iceman, who's known as Bobby in this film. It isn't much of a story. In fact, the story always seemed like an introduction rather than being a great plot. It introduces the characters well, but really doesn't do anything other than that. The whole mutant transformation machine plot isn't very strong. In fact, it's actually the least memorable part of the movie. One part that's really memorable is the movie's brief telling of Wolverine's backstory. It doesn't go into too much detail, but it is something to watch because the series would go into more detail later on. What's also memorable is the small side plot about mutants being outcasted and feared, and Magneto's fight against the human race. That's a plot that would play a big role later on in the series as well. There are two things that are really memorable, and that's the action and the acting. The action I consider to be memorable because it's both impressive and rather outrageous. X-Men's lower than average action film budget does show on a couple occasions, and it's mainly in the action scenes because there are some lame wire tricks that they try to use to avoid adding more CGI. But the action is definitely fun to watch, and my favorite action scene is always the subway station. The acting is definitely memorable. X-Men had a tremendous cast. First, you have to start off with the two leaders, Charles Xavier and Magneto, played by Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen. Stewart and McKellen were both perfect. Stewart was apparently Bryan Singer's only choice for the role, and said if Stewart turned it down, he would not make the film. Stewart is one of those actors where even though the characters are fictional, he makes them seem very real. The same could be said for McKellen. I was a little worried about McKellen in the role because he did seem a little too old for the part, but like Stewart, he makes the character real, and just the way he plays the character makes him the coolest comic book villain in film history. The rest of the cast is also very expertly casted. Hugh Jackman caught everybody by surprise with his performance as Wolverine because he played the character's personality perfectly. James Marsden, I thought, made a pretty good Cyclops. Famke Yassine, I thought, did okay as Jean Grey. They didn't really allow her much range in the script to really give that great of a performance, but she does fine overall. Halle Berry as Storm, I didn't particularly care for. Berry doesn't seem to really want to give her all on some occasions, and she also tries to pull off Storm's accent from the cartoon, which fails big time. I think the only other standout in the cast is Rebecca Romijn as Mystique. Romijn doesn't have a whole lot of dialogue, in fact she only has one line, but she gives the character such great presence on screen that the character feels bigger than she actually was. Also, the makeup job on her for the part is very impressive. So overall, with the first X-Men, the story does feel a bit hollow in areas, especially with the main plot, but with such a great cast and cool action, it's definitely worth watching. X-Men proved to be a surprise hit and gave Fox and other studios confidence in restarting the comic book film genre. It would also greenlight a sequel to X-Men, X2, X-Men United. Due to X-Men's success, Bryan Singer did not have to fight over budget with Fox and was given far more creative freedom. The story this time delves into Wolverine's backstory a lot more. He meets Colonel William Stryker, a military scientist who is out to destroy all mutants on the planet, and is also the man who gave Wolverine his metal skeleton. He kidnaps Charles Xavier and uses his mutant son Jason to control him and use Cerebro to kill all mutants on the planet. It's now up to the X-Men and surprisingly Magneto to stop Stryker. The plot is far more well-rounded than the first X-Men. It's one of those stories that just really has you engrossed from the first minute. And I must admit, when it was announced that Bryan Singer was given creative freedom, it did have me a little worried, because Singer has admitted that he never read the comics before he made his X-Men movies. So I'm sure I wasn't the only one who was a little nervous about the results. But he turned this into a great, action-packed, and rather dramatic story, and it's one of my favorites among comic films. One complaint that I didn't agree with among fans was the first two films focused too much on Wolverine and no one else. Since Wolverine is the most popular character among the X-Men lineup, it was natural that he would be the main focus. But the movie also focuses on other characters as well. It's not just about Wolverine. It focuses on Rogue's character, and the other big focus was on Jean and her constantly changing powers, which would play a big part in the next film. So Wolverine might have been the main plot, but Singer made secondary plots that would play for later on in the series. The action in CGI is loads better. While the CGI in the first film was a bit off, I never really complained about it because the first film's budget didn't really give them time to really enhance a lot of the CG, so some of it looks spectacular and the rest looks half done. And like I said, the action of the first film did have some lame wire work. The second film doesn't have that problem. A bigger budget gave them a lot more freedom and gave them time to work out the action scenes more and make the effects more realistic. Now, not to sound nitpicky or anything, but there was one effect throughout the film that didn't look as good as the first film, and that's Wolverine's claws. They tried to give them more detail and make them bigger in the second film, and for some reason, that made them look a bit off. The acting is just as good, if not better, than the first film, and that says a lot given the fact that the first film had tremendous acting itself. The entire main cast returns with some great additions. The acting from the main cast is great, especially from Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen. The new additions are also great. First, we have Brian Cox as William Stryker. He gives such a great performance. I think what makes it a great performance is that he plays it very subtly. The character doesn't scream a lot, but for some reason that makes him more menacing. Then there's Alan Cummings as Nightcrawler, and he performs it perfectly. I actually had to watch the film several times before actually recognizing Cummings in the role. They did such a great makeup job on him. Another main addition was Aaron Stanford as Pyro, and it took me a while to get used to him in the part. I have to admit, I wasn't really crazy about him in the role the first time watching the film, but I eventually liked him in the role. The only other addition that really caught my eye was Kelly Hu as Lady Deathstrike. I do like the way Kelly Hu performs the character. The only part I'm disappointed with is the fact that they didn't write her as a long-term villain. They actually kill her off in the end, which I thought was the only letdown of the film. So overall, X2 is much more well-rounded than the first film, the story feels more complete, and the acting, action, and effects are all better. So X2 is simply great.